know of hope. Hope for the hopeless and hope for the lost, no matter the price, whatever the cost. Jesus had come and was willing to pay, being born as a babe that first Christmas day. Hope that's a certainty, hope that is sure. Though the earth is shaken, I am secure. Trusting in Jesus and safe in his care, knowing that he's with me and always there.
Thank you, Dana. It's good to be in that time of the year where we start that season of remembrance again and of giving and remembering what that Jesus, the gift of Jesus coming down to earth to show us how to live and bringing forth the Easter season as well. So good morning, everyone. Welcome all here. The call to worship is found in Psalms 31, verse 24. Be strong and take heart, all of you who hope in the Lord. To go over just a few announcements, one is, and it'll be a prayer request as well, but we also we want to remember there's a few people from our church who are on a mission trip currently. They're coming back from the Calgary, the Shoeboxes. So that is, we want to remember, that's Jazzy and Allison Unger and Jessica Hebert, Trish Cron, and Peter is driving. So they're actually heading home, I believe, now. So let's pray for them. So that's praise item and also something, yeah, give thanks for. In the back of your book, when you guys leave, maybe some of you done already, check your mailboxes. There's financial budget proposals. There's a bunch of financial statements and stuff like that from our church and the conference. So please take note of that. That is for tomorrow. So bring those along as well. Another thing for tomorrow, because we're having a membership meeting, we're going to be talking about committee sign-up sheets and stuff. So there's one, it's in the first note here of announcements. There's in the foyer and also in the downstairs on the bulletin board. But if you are interested in serving in a certain area in the church, you're welcome to do that. So just put your name down on that. We'll discuss that tomorrow. Or if you, maybe not yourself, but you know of someone else who you think would be very gifted in that area of service within the church, don't sign their name up, but ask them to put their name on there. And then we'll discuss those things tomorrow. Another thing with that too, is you do not have to be, you might be here and not a member. You do not have to be a member to be on certain boards. So if you are a non-member but you're actively involved, and hey, you know what, I wouldn't mind volunteering here, put your name down on there, and let's see how that goes tomorrow. So for tomorrow membership meeting, that's at 7 o'clock. There's minutes in the back on the in the bulletin board, so you can go over them from the last time we had one. I want to really, the agenda is there. So it's financial update 2022. We have a budget proposal. There's conference budget stuff. There's committee elections, which I talked about. There's the Grunthal Cemetery Board discussion there and our involvement there. There's a building project update. There's also a presentation discussion on our church and local missions. So these are some pretty big items. And we're talking about unity, we're talking about our church involvement and just coming forth as a family. And you might, maybe you've never been at a membership meeting, maybe you've come but haven't come for a while, maybe you come all the time. And if you've never come, I encourage you to come out and try it. We want to, just because you'll see a budget proposal, that doesn't mean that that is all written in stone. Just because you didn't put a number forth because you're not part of a committee, doesn't mean that we as a church, we all come on those things together. Different things with missions, involvement with the Grunthal Cemetery. We all have a voice, we are a membership-driven church. So I encourage everyone to come out tomorrow, 7 o'clock, and come check it out. One more announcement I want to go over, and that is we had an assistant bishop election a few Sundays ago. And Pastor Stan Friesen was elected for another 5-year term. So Stan Friesen was elected. For praise and prayer requests, Richard Anna Reimer, serving at Winkler Bible Camp. Family of the week is Dave and Helen Martins. Workers of the Week is Library Committee, Marianne Falk and Mary Bergen. Church of the Week is the Grunthal Burteller. Pray that we would be a church that stands for the truth. Margaret Buhler, Stone Vital Hospital, Peter Mary Reimer. That's it for prayer requests. If I can ask the usher to come forward this time, and we'll spend some time in prayer, and then we'll ask Simon, Joe, and Jake to come up and lead us in song. Let's bow our head in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Jesus, we come before you this day. We thank you so much for this day that you have given us, the day that we can set aside as a Sabbath, the day that we can set aside for rest, or we can gather here in praise and worship to you, Lord, where we can be unified together as a church family, where we can worship you, Lord God, where we can pray with one another, encourage one another in a church setting. Lord, thank you so much for this day. I want to pray, Lord God, that be with Pastor Eric this morning as he's presenting the message, the people that are doing the music, Lord God, that whatever is said and done, thinking of the Sunday school teachers, that would be honoring to you, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would move among us people, Lord God, that we would be moved, Lord God, for your name's sake, Lord, strengthen us. Lord, I want to pray for, bring these people before you as prayer requests, Richard and Anna Reimer. Thank you, Lord God, for the work that they're doing in Winkler, and as they've transitioned there from Camp Cedarwood, Lord God, I pray that that transition has been smooth, Lord God, and that you would bless them in the work that they're doing. Pray also for Dave and Helen Martins. Lord, I want to thank you for them. I want to pray, Lord God, that you continue to bless them as a couple, Lord God, as a family. Bless their home, Lord God, and the things that you have in store for them. Lord, I want to thank you for our library committee and the work that they do. And it's ask you continue to bless their work, give them insight, and give them enjoyment in this area of service for you. Pray for the Grunthal Burteller Church. And their prayer request is that they would be a church that stands for truth. And we pray for that, Lord. Help to stand firm. Help us all to stand firm in that, Lord God, for that's what we do. It's truth. And to know what is real truth, Lord God, and that's the Bible. Pray for Margaret Buhler, Pete Mary Reimer, Lord God. Be with these individuals, Lord God, and the health struggles that they're having, Lord God. And along with that comes other things. And Lord God, we ask that your hand of healing and comfort would be upon them, Lord God. You touch them in a special way, Lord God. And they would know that you are there near them, Lord. We would know that, Lord. Lord, again, thank you for this day. I want to pray your blessings upon it. Pray for this offering this morning, that whatever is given would be used for your honor and your glory. And in return, we say thank you, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made. We have come into his house and gathered in. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes. rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be
It is a beautiful morning when we can worship God regardless of whether the sun is beautifully shining or not. And those are beautiful words that we get to sing. There are times when singing those different songs or hymns, in this case, the simple one that we usually teach our kids, it's amazing how many lines of that song are always... It's not just a simple children's song. There's good theology in it. There's beautiful words. And they cover a multitude of scripture passages. Hebrews 9 verse 27 says, "Just as a man is destined to die once, and after that face judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. And he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him." Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, this morning, as we'd like to say every morning, but specifically the day that we have chosen to set aside for your worship and praise, a day of rest, we thank you. We thank you for the hope that we have in you. And as we look to your word, I pray that you would change your people, you would touch their hearts, and you would be glorified. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for your word, and thank you for your people. In your name, amen. A lady by the name of Michelle L. Hardy, who lives in Holland, Michigan, wrote an article, a very short one, on her kids. And it goes like this. "Advent was 1 week away, so we thought we would see what our children remembered from our family devotions the year before. Who can tell me what the four candles in the Advent wreath represent?" I asked. Luke jumped in with a seven-year-old wisdom and exuberance. "There's love, joy, peace, and I know," six-year-old Elise interrupted to finish her brother's sentence, "peace and quiet." Not quite, but close. Advent. Christmas Advent. It's interesting. Depending on the country or of origin or the denomination, actually, of the church, there are many, many traditions. Just a little, I won't give any, but just doing a little research on Advent, it's amazing the different multitudes of ways that God gets worshipped in our amazing world. The word Advent means coming or arrival of something important. Traditionally, this season, the church has been invited to reflect upon Christ's first coming, as well as his life, death, and resurrection, and also his return of his coming again. Hopefully, it's a time of repentance and preparation. It's a time of anticipation and of joyful hope. Today we lit the candle of hope, and we place our hope in God. We place our hope in His promises. We place our trust in His Holy Scriptures. We place our hope in Jesus Christ and His sacrifice, trusting that our sins are forgiven and that we will spend eternity with Him in heaven. Now, in my lifetime, which isn't all that long, Christmas has always been very specifically the celebration of the birth of Jesus Christ. Now, tradition, when we think, it's usually an extended period of time. It's not just a week or two. It's something that is constant. And yet, traditions do change. It's my desire, though, that to have the tradition to continue to worship and remembering the birth of Jesus Christ, to have that continue until He actually does come again. Traditions such as Advent are good, but no tradition should ever overshadow Jesus Christ and the celebration of Him. Today, I'd like to spend some time looking at some of the promises we receive that bring us hope for the future. A future when Jesus, the Son of God, the Messiah, the promised one, the Savior of the world, comes again to set things right. Despite whether we call it Advent or despite what traditions we add to it, Jesus needs to stay, or the focal point of our worship and admiration. I'm going to turn to Hebrews chapter 12. In verse 2, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says this: "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before Him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." Always fixing our eyes on Jesus. Now, this is a church. We do that all the time, right? Well, in the sermon, in our Sunday school teachings, in our conversations, there's lots of talk, and more often than not, a little bit of Scripture. Sometimes that seems the wrong way to look at it, but I think it's because when you read one passage of Scripture, you can spend a day discussing it. But let's not take our focus off of Jesus Christ. We have a great season around us. The white snow, the sun glistening off of it, the lights that we see, the tinsel, all the glorification of the season takes us very quickly away from it. And yet Jesus always brings us back to the simple. He, in joy, endured the cross, scorning the shame, and He's sitting at the right hand of the throne of God. That's important because we're going to look at a couple of promises of God, of Jesus Christ, the same. And he has to have the authority for that promise to stick. And he's sitting at the right hand of the throne of God. So what are a couple of promises of God? Well, as I said, in order to accept the promise of someone, we must earn and prove that we can be trusted or trust that person. If I promise to give you something or do something to you, in order for you to believe me, I have to earn that trust or have proven it before or elsewhere. In the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, God makes a proclamation. And with that proclamation, there's a lot to it. And that, I think, can help us trust or set up the trust that we need in God to accept the promises that are coming. Revelations 1, verses 7 and 8. We don't usually read these when we talk about Christmas. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the peoples of the earth will mourn because of them, or because of him, sorry. So shall it be, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. There's a lot in that. We look with anticipation to the second coming of Jesus Christ. We expect him to come. When Revelation was given to John and he was telling that, it was close to the end of his time here on earth. Most of the apostles, if not all of them, had already passed on. And so when he says these words that he's coming and every eye will see him, we initially respond, well, yeah, whoever's alive will. But it goes beyond that. Even those who pierced him. Odds are at the time of the writing of Revelation, those soldiers would have passed on as well. Not just from age, but from job hazards. Back then, most of the men and women didn't live to 60, 70, 80 years of age, especially those who were in the army. So the odds are that they have passed. And the words that John wrote didn't automatically get scattered throughout. We have them today. So when Jesus comes, it's not just the living, but those who have passed on preceding Jesus and preceding us, and for those in the future. Every eye will see him. No idea how that's going to work, but I trust it because of some of the other things that he says. I am the Alpha and the Omega. Who is, who was, and who is to come. Now, either the God in this case who said these words, Jesus, was nuts, ludicrous, crazy. Nobody would say that they are at the beginning and the end unless they mean it, unless they back it up. And just like the words that said before, all eyes will see him. I think the approximate population of the world is somewhere around 8 billion right now. I think they finally passed that mark. And for the thousands of years that have gone before, how are they all going to see him? I don't know, but they will. And I think because of some of those statements, we can trust when God makes other promises. But before we get to those, I want to make mention of this. In verse 7, it says, and all the people of the earth will mourn because of him. I like the King James Version in this case, where it says, all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. When I think of mourn, I think of sadness, I think of contemplation, but it's usually because I've lost something, not because I'm feeling a lot of pain. And that's my own interpretation. So when I read that they will wail because of him, I stopped and I thought, why is that word different? Well, mourning, wailing because of mourning, is because of a great sadness. And I think that the second coming of our God here in this passage is going to cause mourning and grief. I believe it's because the world will see Jesus for who he is. They will recognize the King of Kings. And we will mourn with wailing, knowing that we crucified him. Our sins will be extremely obvious to us when we are in the presence of a holy God. When faced with a perfect, all-powerful Creator, I think we're going to cringe remembering the wrongs committed against one another and ultimately against God. Think of it this way. When you've done something wrong, and I like to go back to my childhood, not just for the mistakes I've made, but I can clearly remember when I did something I know I shouldn't, and I felt guilt, and whether I faced up to it or not, or even in before the process of getting disciplined for it, even before that, when mom or dad would walk into the room or you'd have to go see them, there's more guilt. I knew I did something wrong, and I could ignore it because I did it in the first place. My sin didn't bother me much. But the minute I got into the presence of authority, I was worried. One, I'd be caught. If I was caught, two, I'd get disciplined. So when Jesus comes and the world sees him, both the dead and the living, to me that brings forth that thought of my sins will be so blatantly obvious to me. Time kind of wears them down, but they won't be at that point because we will be in the presence of a perfect God. I'm not just going to be mourning for my sin, hanging my head. I think we're going to be afraid. It's going to bring us to wail and weep, not fake-like, as they used to do in some of the cases. They would hire professional mourners at a funeral to cry and wail. But I think we will all be broken to our core when we come into the perfect presence of God. So when that God makes a promise, it makes me stop and cringe, but also to trust the promise. Going back to Hebrews. Excuse me. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 and 6. Here's a promise. Now, this isn't specifically based upon the Christmas season, and we're not there this morning, but it's based upon a promise of God. Hebrews 13, 5 says, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. Nice statement. Because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. The Lord is my helper. When we do a task, we always want someone to help us. Well, I say always. When we're young and have nothing but unlimited energy, I can do it myself, comes across, at least for the guys. But we also know that we can do sometimes not just twice as much, but we can do more than double when there's two working together. If you can't carry something, two of you can carry so much more. So here God promises to never leave us, forsake us, and be our helper. This comes out of Deuteronomy. In Deuteronomy chapter 31, that is where this is taken from. And the Israelites are being told this after they've made the trek through the desert. They're about to go into the new land. And then these words are stated twice in two different verses. Deuteronomy 31, verses 6 and verse 8. And he says, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them. And he's talking about the foreigners, or soon to be foreigners in the promised land. For the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. After spending 40 years in the desert, and all of those who started the trek have been passed on, they're told, God will not leave you. Verse 8 repeats it again. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. So when we read that passage in Hebrews, the Israelites, going, this was written to them, they were the first recipients of the book of Hebrews, they would have understood that context. And this is thousands of years afterwards, and they know that when they put God first, that he didn't leave them. They always found that when they gave up their worship of the true God and followed the worldly gods, that they were punished and disciplined. But God was still waiting for them. And when they turned back to him, these promises came through. So there's a future promise for us. We're following, if we follow God, he will not leave you. He will always be our helper. And to make that point one more time, if we turn into the book of Psalms, in Psalms 118, he says the same concept. 118 of the book of Psalms, verse 6 and 7. The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? The Lord is with me. He is my helper. I will look in triumph on my enemies. We all like to be independent, but we all know that the older we get, especially, that actually we need others and we get more done. We are more productive. It works better. So to have the help of the Creator of the universe is a big deal. It's a beautiful promise, not just for today, but for all of eternity. Let's look at another promise. And it was actually in one of our songs. John chapter 14. John chapter 14, the first couple of verses, verses 1 through 3. It says this. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Nice after what we just read. Trust in God. These are the words of Jesus. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and I will take you with me, take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. In my Father's house are many rooms. Jesus, throughout the Gospels, didn't at first say it, but he did say it in the end. When he asked Peter, who do you say I am? You are the Messiah, the Son of God. In that context, Jesus says, in my Father's house. So God is his Father, another proclamation of his deity. There are many rooms. We go, okay. In our society, we like our space and our stuff. We like our individuality. Growing up with seven brothers and sisters, some of you understand the large family prospects, some don't. I shared a room with my brothers until I think there was one left before I finally had my own room. And oh, did I like my own space. So when we read in my Father's house are many rooms, I go, well, all I get is a room? There's a part of my sinful nature creeps in there. But the context here is a little different. If you would go to visit a relative, if I would go to Alberta and visit my brother or my sister and brother-in-law, I would say, it's okay. I don't want to stay in your house and put you out. I'd rather pay extra money and stay in a hotel or go with a camper or something. Yet we all probably would say to our relatives, as they say to me, come, live with me. Why would you spend the money? We like our space. But that's not good hospitality if they don't offer it. In this culture, it wasn't just offering a room. If you come and take a room, your food's paid for, your shelter's paid for, you have the opportunity to spend time with the family as family. Everything is taken care of. You have nothing to worry about. It wasn't just hospitality. It was, you are welcome in my house. You are my sibling. You are equal to me. So when Jesus says, I'm going to give you a room in my Father's house, I don't know if it's a palace room, if it's a cubbyhole, a place to sleep, but there is shelter, there is peace, there is no worries. I am treated as a child, a part of the family. And that's not just for a nice house, like we would think, well, what's it look like? Are the colors, can I change them? No, our individuality wants to come out. This is for all eternity. The creator of the universe is going to be generous. Look at our world. There's 8 billion people, and yet we have how much space, food, shelter, natural resources. And it's been going on for thousands of years. When God promises a room, you can be guaranteed it's going to be amazing. That's a wonderful promise. Another promise. It's a promise that we've mentioned here a little bit, and it's a promise that is in the New Testament many times. Eternal life. The Old Testament doesn't talk about eternal life in those words, but it does talk about it. Not very much. In the New Testament, we hear it all the time. Believe in me, and I will give you eternal life. I will spend, as we read back in John, it says, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. And it is that context of everlasting. I'm going to read a passage of Isaiah, chapter 26. In Isaiah 26, verse 19, he's talking praise. He's giving praise up to God. And he's talking to the Israelites after there's been some problems. And he says this in verse 19, but your dead will live, your bodies will rise, you who dwell in the dust, wake up, shout for joy. Your dew is like the dew of the morning. The earth will give birth to her dead. Sounds kind of depressing if you just read about death, but there's life in that. For thousands of years, this world's spinning through nothing, through space, and people have been born, and they live, and they die. Death is a part of life. And it can be depressing when I think about, well, yeah, but there's an end to all this wonderful thing that I call life. But Isaiah here says, the bodies will rise, the dead will live. And at that time, we're going to shout for joy. Now, it doesn't say you will get eternal life, but he does talk about the dead rising. On that context, we'll turn to the book of Daniel. In the book of Daniel, chapter 12. Now, the book of Daniel is this wonderful book about the future, and it talks in word pictures. It's not something that we say, well, this is exactly what happens. And yet, it talks about eternal life. In Daniel chapter 12, and he's having a vision, and he says this, at that time, Michael, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. There will be a time of disaster, of distress, sorry, such as not happened from the beginning of nations until then. So he's giving a prophecy about the future. Okay? Talking about the same time that Revelation does. But at that time, your people, everyone whose name is found written in the book, will be delivered. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. The promise of eternal life. Some contempt, some to just everlasting life, according to this passage. That's a beautiful promise, isn't it? Why do we want to remember those promises? It's Christmas. There's gifts. There's lights on the tree. There's driving around looking and see who spent more money on Christmas lights in their yards. I'm glad they do it. It's beautiful, but I don't want to spend the money. And we get caught up in that. Black Friday was something I think the states started, and now it could be Black Friday month. Like, depends what you want to buy. Like, the sales never end. There's always a good sale, always a good deal, always something you need or you should spoil yourself with. Well, that's going to pass away. That's why we have to have sales, because everything breaks. Jesus Christ doesn't break. He doesn't even break us. A bruised reed, he will not break. Jesus is offering us eternity, either with him or without him. And he started that. He gave that promise in the Old Testament. But at the birth of his son, salvation came to us. This is why we celebrate. This is why we, some cultures, they actually mourn with weeping. They're fasting. It's a very somber occasion, the weeks preceding the time that they talk about the birth of Jesus Christ. God had to suffer and die once he was born. We celebrate. And rightly so, it's a good thing to celebrate. But let's not forget why. It's always about Jesus. And let's not forget not just the birth of Christ, because as a man, he had to suffer and die. But just like Jesus, we will suffer and die. But because he didn't stay there, we won't either. So as we celebrate Christmas, let's celebrate the promises. Eternal life. God always is with us. He will never leave you nor forsake you. And he's got a place for us. Maybe it's just a room in a mansion. Maybe it's an entire mansion. Maybe I get to sleep out in the grass. But we get to spend eternity with him. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word this morning and the ability, the chance to flip back and forth in it and find promises throughout it. We only touched a few of them, Father. Thank you for that this morning. Thank you for promising us good, awesome things from a great, amazing God. Thank you for reminding us that we can trust in your promises because of what you've done up to this point and what you will do in the future. Bless your people, and as we celebrate Christmas, may we never lose sight of the reason what we're celebrating for, the birth of a Savior to save us from ourselves. Thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Sorry.
That's okay.
I almost started on the other one.
Oh.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thine is glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine is glory. Revive us again. O God, for the Spirit of life, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our life. Hallelujah, thine is glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine is glory. Revive us again. Glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sins and has cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, thine is glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine is glory. Revive us again. Revive us again. Fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine is glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine is glory. Revive us again.
Great words to sing. May we actually offer that up throughout the week with as much or more exuberance. When's the last time you shouted hallelujah? Aside from when you stubbed your toe? That's a word that praises, that we need to shout out for the awesome God that we have. Numbers 6. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace.